Hi, I'm David, that generator guy. If you have any need for a generator, if you have questions, please give me a call. I'll shoot straight with you. We'll do the best possible job for you. You're going to end up with a great result, a great value, and the biggest thing is absolute reliability. Call me at 985-355-0451.
Well, Police Chief Bree Larrison from Ponchatoula certainly is illustrative these days of the old premise, when it rains, it pours. Three shootings, one murder in about a month in a very quiet town, which Ponchatoula is.
It has been. It's been a rough month, Ken, and we're down 8 police officers, so that's the most turnover we've ever had in the history of our department. Obviously, we had the death of Corporal Pearson. We had the understandably early retirement of her husband, Captain Larry Pearson. My deputy chief retired after 50-plus years in law enforcement. One of my captains left to work with our new sheriff. So I lost a lieutenant and two sergeants. So we're trying to get new officers back on the force to get our community back protected at the prior numbers that we had.
Well, are you planning to make another plea to what is now a new city council and a new mayor for pay raises?
We're going to continue working for pay raises. First, we have to work to get the two positions back that they cut in this year's budget. We're at 27 sworn now, where we've been at 29 sworn for the last probably 10 years.
Sometimes in law enforcement, you're a victim of success, because if you do a great job, it looks like you don't need much of a police department. But on the other hand, three shootings in a month, is that unprecedented?
That's very unprecedented. We probably haven't had three in the last 10 years. So it's new times, it's challenging times, and we need a larger police department, and we need to pay our guys accordingly.
So are these related in any way, these three incidents?
We believe two of them are related. The murder was not related. The attempted murder and the drive-by shooting of a residence, we believe, will be related.
Well, is it gang-related, or what caused it?
We believe so, yeah. They will be gang-related.
You know, the Hammond Ponchatoula had a lot of gang activity. You and Edwin Bergeron in Hammond got it under control, or so it would appear. Is it coming back?
It appears to be coming back, yeah. And crime always usually picks up during the summer when the kids are out of school. So school's starting in a few weeks. Hopefully that'll settle some of this stuff down.
But still, I mean, do you have any extraordinary measures with the department now that you've had this shooting spree?
Yeah, we're just having to be a lot more proactive. We're having to get out there and make a lot more traffic stops and get the guns and the drugs off our streets.
So is that the common denominator, that kids these days, whether they're in a gang or not, they're just more likely to have a gun? It's a status symbol.
They are, yeah. With the social media and everybody wanting to be gangbangers, you know, there's a lot more guns on our streets. And when we increase the traffic enforcement, we're going to lower the crime rate.
So you're operating substantially down in your department, even at a time like this.
We are, yeah, substantially.
So what do you do as far as a strategy of policing? I mean, knowing that you're several men down.
We had to move resources around. We have a deputy chief and a captain position that I haven't filled, because I got to fill police officer positions first. We moved detectives out of the detective bureau into patrol. So we're just trying to do the best we can with what limited resources we have.
What do you hear from City Hall?
I'm working well with the new mayor. I hadn't had a chance to get with many council members yet, but we're too busy just trying to take care of the basics right now.
What else are you working on? Boy, that's enough.
It's enough. I mean, I'm out there patrolling myself, Ken, answering calls, and, you know, just trying to do what we can to keep our community safe.
What's new for your current term? I mean, you just started a new term.
Just started a new term, and we're starting a new rebuilding of our police department. Well, there'll be a lot of new faces. You know, we'll have to get a lot of these younger guys the training that they need, but we'll continue to do the great job that we've done the last 16 years.
And it's hard to recruit in police work around here. You know, Hammond pays the most, and everybody else is doing the same thing you're doing, trying to recruit.
Correct. You have to pay your officers to get good quality officers, and most importantly, to keep them. So that's what we'll continue discussing with the council and with our citizens.
Well, our acting assessor, Kevin Rayford, is especially busy this time of year because, well, number one, it's a reassessment year, and secondly, the tax bills are about to go out this fall. First, when will we get our tax notices?
They should come out 1st of November. We'd like to maybe do them a little before if we can, if everything goes perfect. and we get everything to the sheriff's office. You know, we'd like to try to get them out in October, but definitely in November for sure.
What does it mean that it's a reassessment year?
So basically what we have to do as the assessor, we have to go around the whole parish, and we have to, it's a mass assessment, but we look at all the values across the parish, and we look and see whether they increase or decrease. And then once we make that assessment, we send everything out to all the taxing districts so that they can decide whether they're going to roll their millage forward or back and keep the same millage they had before to get the same income they had last year, or roll forward to get an additional income based on the millage that was levied that was passed. So we've done all that. They've had all that. They're doing all their meetings now so that they can get that information back to me so that I can get it to the tax commission, the Louisiana Legislative Auditor, so that we can get everything to the sheriff's office and get our tax roll approved.
Pretty safe bet that most people are going to see an increase.
Absolutely. As I've said before, we will see an increase. It's not anything that anybody needs to be alarmed about. It's, you know, my staff took a lot of time looking into it to make sure that we did it right and it's fair. And I think everybody will notice that it is a fair assessment when they get it. So it's nothing, anything that they need to be alarmed about. I think they'll understand.
What are we talking about? We're getting maybe 5% growth a year, something like that?
We've always been around that 5% growth a year, but you're going to see somewhere between 8 to 10% on this increase for this reassessment. And again, we did that across the board throughout the whole parish. And like I said, again, you'll see it. And I think it'd be real hard for anybody to think that values haven't increased in our parish over the last 4 years. So, it, again, nobody wants taxes. I don't want taxes. But it does provide a service to our area, and it's what we have to have the community that we want. Everybody wants to talk about all the different things that come with having a good parish as we have. And, you know, Robbie, our parish president, talks about you want to move here, live here. We're the best parish in the state. And those are just things that we have to do to continue to be the best parish in the state.
Looking over these numbers then, are you seeing any surprising trends? For example, where is the growth? Yeah, we know about Bedeco, but I'm in La Ronja where I see it a lot.
It is, and I've said that over the last year or so, Ken. We definitely see it moving to the central part and the northern part of the parish, and I think we're going to continue to see that once people get up that way and see how nice the parish is on the north end and what land you have and the space that you have up there. So I do think you'll continue to see that, and we do see that. You know, just recently there was a report out that Tangipahoa Parish has a steady increase in land values, and we've always said that. We want a slow, steady increase, and we continue to see that.
I know on the commercial end, you've seen big increases.
Correct, definitely. Our commercial sector has made it through all the low parts and has continued to do well in Tangipahoa Parish. And again, I think it's just a testament to what we have to offer here in Tangipahoa Parish and what makes our parish so great.
I am told by people that know more than me about the subject that somehow in your reassessments, you try to spread it out over several years instead of hitting people with one big jump in a reassessment year.
That's right. That's correct. We look at every sale that comes through, and we make the adjustments then. And then at the end, you know, you just have to look at it to make sure everything's together. We do a real good job of going through and looking at all of our subdivisions and make sure that they're all grouped together and make sure that there's no outliers in there. So there's a lot that goes into it. You know, and then the commercial side of it is even more that goes into it. There's different low-income tax credits that we have to pay attention to, and there's different laws that, you know, tell us and govern how we do certain things on the commercial side of it. So it's just a lot goes into it. It's not an easy process, that's for sure.
People don't realize it, but the assessor's office is directly involved in recruiting new industry. Very often they're a player, and I can cite several instances I know about that. If the assessor hadn't come through, the industry wouldn't have come here.
That's absolutely correct. In my office, actually, I participated in a seminar Monday for the ITEP program, and they're continuing to look, you know, to how to continue to offer that program and how to make that program better. And we in my office, me particularly, I go to every seminar that they have in that so that we can continue to offer those services and make our parish better.
So are we worth $1 billion now?
We are. We are. I just looked at that yesterday, and as an assessed value, we are. And we've been getting close to that value. I will report that in a couple months, but yes.
How does that equate to just absolute value?
You know, the assessed value and absolute, I mean, that's just a huge number. But we just continue to push and try to bring on good businesses. And you know, again, our parish president does a good job with that. And it's just a big number. How about that, Ken?
$1 million got my attention.
Exactly. When you say that, it just really puts you in a whole nother world. And again, we're just blessed to live in a wonderful parish and have wonderful people, just like we have here today. It's just a great event.
What else do you want to tell us?
That's it. Just, football season's coming. I just went to the SLU Coaches Caravan a couple days ago, and just get out and support our local sports, our local university. Southeastern's a wonderful university and a great tool that we have here in Hammond. So, get out, support our local teams, Southeastern football, baseball, soccer, all of them. Get out there, support, help be a part of making the university as good as it is for our parish.
Our friends from Pride Roofing always have something very interesting to talk about. Seems like all roads lead to Rome. For example, we just had a state senator tell us that roofs are critical in getting our insurance rates down, and fortified roofs can be a big help.
Yeah, we are fortified certified. And then, the state of Alabama was the first one to get on board with the fortified program, and now it's spreading all over the Gulf Coast. Your insurance rates will go down if you have a fortified roof. And there's a lot of procedures to get it fortified. A third-party inspector will inspect the work throughout the process, and there's a lot of pictures involved. There's a lot of additional materials that will make that'll strengthen your roof and make it fortified certified.
But after a storm, most property owners, they're in such a big hurry to get a roof. I mean, I can't imagine that they'd be particular about it.
Well, you've got to be careful, because when a storm comes through, there's a lot of storm chasers. Many of them are not licensed, they're not certified, they're not fortified certified, so be careful with that. Use a local company with a bricks and mortar warehouse. Use that, yeah.
Of course, you moved into a big facility here in Hammond.
We're still there. We have a large inventory of shingles and metal. We do a lot of metal, standing seam, ag panel, PBR panel, a lot of variety of roofing materials that we use on a day-to-day basis.
Do you find that insurance companies recognize the fortified roofs?
We do. We're seeing that they're actually reducing the premiums. You have to have the certification, though. You have to have a certificate that says fortified certified.
We're all just waiting to see if we get another hurricane this year.
Yeah, they said it's a busy season. We're starting to get a lot of rain and bad weather. It's all going to come. It always, what goes around comes around. So we're going to see more and more storms.
Well, we're getting these afternoon thunder boomers, and I imagine I've had hail several times at my house. There's some roofs being damaged now.
Yeah, just little weekend blow-ups or during the week, you could get wind and hail. Last night, we had a lot of rain around town and a lot where I live, so I flooded in certain areas. So it's only going to get worse this time of year. Be ready for it.
Well, Alex, how's the new facility in Hammond coming? Last time I was out there, you weren't quite finished.
I think we're 90% finished now. We got a little bit more inventory. Now we got also some like storage of buildings, custom metal buildings that we also have, like some in this place that people can come look at it and see if they like what we have in the yard. And if they pick one, we can go and build it in their own yard.
Kept the other location in Livingston.
That's correct, yes, sir. Crown's Metal is in Albany.
Yeah, you guys are growing.
Yeah, a little bit at a time. But today we're here, where is this place? Like, why not pizza? That's where we are today, and celebrating Mr. Benny's birthday.
Benny Latino is a patriarch of the parish. You can see how many friends he has, and I don't think this crowd is ever going to dissipate.
It's a big crowd, though. You can tell that the man is well-known, and, along with Shorty Roger, everybody know this place. These the two guys that the history and the parish, though.
It's rare that we keep these, and this is not that old. I mean, it's not like 100 years old, but we lose so many of these old-timers. We lose the buildings, and sometimes I think we're marching into the future too fast.
Yeah, Shorty's pretty close. he's been around, and great guy to know. I used to work for the man. I used to work for Shorty.
Before I leave here, I'm going to find out just exactly how old he is. I know he's in his 80s.
I think he's 90, 91, Shorty.
That's unbelievable.
And you can see how many people that still recognize it. He's, everybody that is here, they're happy to see it. A lot of people came from Ponchatoula and Livingston Parish just to see Mr. Benny and Mr. Shorty.
Well, you know, Pride Roofing is the name to remember if there's a storm or anything like that, and it's been an incredible economic success story coming here to Tangipahoa. I know Livingston loves to have you as a native company, but the fact that we can grow to this extent of business here in Hammond, Louisiana, to be one of the tops in the state, it says a lot about us.
Yeah, we're blessed to be here. Great people. It's a large parish. From north to south, it's a big parish, a lot of ground to cover here. We did come up with a new program. It's Alex's brain tank. We do a thing called pay at closing. So if a home is listed with a realtor, you know, a potential buyer is going to get a home inspector. 8 out of 10 times, there's something wrong with the roof. So what we'll do with between $1,000 and $2,000 down, the seller will put a new roof on, and then we'll wait and we'll get paid at closing. And after 12 months, there'll be an interest rate that kicks in, a small interest rate. But that's a new program that we offer in this parish.
So no money down and get a new roof.
$1,000 to $2,000 down, and then we put the roof on, and then the rest of the money, the proceeds, will be collected at the closing table.
So if they say the buyer wants a new roof, he can get it.
He can get it. He can get it. Because there's a lot of roof issues in this parish.
Alicia Fusell is our Chief Deputy Clerk of Court in AMEET. And let's be honest, your job is usually not exciting. But there are exceptions to that. For example, in court, we just had a candidate's challenge in the AMEET mayor's race, and it did not succeed, which was a big surprise. So set the table for us a little bit and tell us what happened.
So yesterday, Judge Ricks heard the matter of Walter Daniels versus Ayanna Buchanan. She is running against him for mayor of AMEET. Mr. Daniels was challenging her qualifications as it relates to being a resident of AMEET and also an elector of AMEET. So that's how the challenge was based. However, Judge Ricks ruled in favor of Ms. Buchanan, and her name will be on the ballot in November.
What are the residency requirements, or so they appear?
So as the statute reads, I want to make sure I get it right. So it says that you shall be an elector of the municipality, and at the time of qualifications as the candidate for office shall have been domiciled for a year. So it was a little ambiguous. That was Judge Ricks's words, ambiguous as to being the elector of the municipality, the time frame of it. So they all judges kind of have a tendency to err towards letting people run and letting the people decide who they want to represent them.
So the contention was that she moved to AMEET just recently.
Correct. But she was able to present enough evidence that led Judge Ricks to believe that she met the qualifications. So Judge Ricks allowed her to run.
Of course, Ayanna Buchanan owns several businesses in AMEET.
Correct. Yes. And she's been very involved in the community as well. That was part of her testimony yesterday as well, is her involvement in the community. So.
You know, the whole thing is just unusual. This just doesn't happen that much.
It's always interesting. After qualifying ends, there's approximately a week where someone can be challenged for their qualifications. So everybody's always digging into everybody's qualifications, and then they make the determination if they want to try to challenge that.
You know, this November ballot, everybody thinks about the race for president, but there's a lot of local elections too.
Yes, correct. So we have the new judgeship, Division L, will be on the ballot, which is for the 21st JDC. AMEET has their municipal elections. Roseland and Tangipahoa have their municipal elections as well.
And in some of these little towns, I mean, the local elections, they're as important to some people as the presidential race.
Right. We find that the small races get more heated than the national races here. So yeah, it's very interesting.
A couple of tax propositions, I think, too, in November, although they're also going to be on the December ballot, too.
Yes. So we'll be busy. There will be a lot on the ballot for everybody to consider. Yes.
Is the November election for president, is that the biggest election as far as turnout goes in the four-year period?
Yes, it is. It always is. That definitely brings out the highest number of voters, but still we never reach that 100%, but it definitely brings out the most, yes.
Well, it was going to be Biden versus Trump. A lot of people were saying, well, I'm just not going to vote. But now that we have a real race on our hands, it looks like there's more interest. And I mean, but what is a heavy turnout? 50%?
For a presidential election, it's 68% roughly. So yeah, that would be about the highest.
That's kind of disgusting if you think about it. So 30 or a third of the people never vote ever.
Correct. Yes. It is discouraging. And we try our best to make people aware, you know, our office, the registrar's office, parish government. Some people just don't get engaged in what's going on locally or nationally.
Which is not against the law?
No, absolutely not. That's your choice.
What else do you want to share with us?
That's it. We're just busy in the clerk's office, gearing up for the election. We do have commissioner recruitment schools that are be happening in August. I believe it's the 15th of August. We have it on our website. Or you can give us a call and we'll give you all the information for that. But we're always recruiting people to work in the polls on election. It's very important. It's a very important civic duty. And we're always recruiting. And if you'd like any information about that, please call our office at 985-748-4146.
Nissans are hot, but the prices are cool at Bill Hood Nissan in Hammond. I'm Saints All-Pro defensive end Cam Jordan, and for your next Nissan, forget the rest and come to the best. Bill Hood Nissan is known for the huge selection and no-hassle shopping. So drive a little and save a lot at Bill Hood Nissan in Hammond.
Dr. Millard McElwee came back to Hammond from his day job in California, therein hangs the tale, to conduct a STEM camp for students in this area here at the African American Museum. And first, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah, so I'm a, you want me to hold it or?
No, we'll start over again. Okay, I got the mic. Dr. Millard McElwee came to Hammond, came back home, in fact, to conduct a STEM camp, and that's here where we are, just concluded, as a matter of fact, at the African American Museum. Wow, therein hangs a tale. First, just tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah, so I'm a Louisiana native, born in Metairie, Hammond High graduate of 2011. I went to Carnegie Mellon and studied civil engineering and then on to UC Berkeley. I'd say like the catalyst for me studying engineering was Hurricane Katrina. And I've always felt since then I had an obligation to pay things forward after finishing up my PhD.
You had quite a menu of things for these kids to do. For example, I noticed that you brought them to the Stennis Space Center and also Turtle Cove Research Center.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we wanted to engage them in a variety of activities, hands-on as well as theoretical. And so we've been going to NASA Stennis for several years and supplemented that this year with Turtle Cove. So that research facility is managed by Southeastern, and they're doing great work there.
So you've done this before?
Yes. So I have participated in the STEM camp with the Heritage Center several years in the past, but this is the first year I sort of came to direct it.
So how did you get off? I mean, what do you do as your job?
So I'm a civil engineer or systems engineer by trade. So I work with communities to map their exposure to different hazards. So how things like hurricanes or even forest fires impact certain vulnerable communities.
We could use you back here.
Yeah. So that's, I'm finally getting to or feeling like I'm at a place where, you know what, I want to really invest back into my community. And that's, this is one of the first steps.
Well, coming from California, which is known for a good educational system at all levels, mm-hmm. I mean, you must really see how we in Louisiana, in our area in particular, we have a long way to go for some of these kids.
Yeah, we do have a long way to go, but we are doing some great things. So I know that my wife, she's a teacher, and she taught at LaRonja Elementary School, and now she's teaching at a school in Oakland, California. And it's amazing when she talks about some of the things that Oakland is behind on. But there's still, I agree with you, much opportunity to improve.
Well, it's interesting that we would be ahead of Oakland in education just in some ways.
Yeah. So, for instance, smart boards. So Oakland and much of California hasn't caught up with smart boards. There's still some classrooms using projectors. And so it's interesting to see in some aspects Louisiana is, you know, on the edge.
So with STEM, you're reaching a certain group of kids who are interested in science and technology and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
it occurs to me that not everybody is.
Yeah. So not everyone is interested in science, technology, engineering, and math. But what I've tried to do here is just show them a variety of applications, whether it's space or physics, just to get them, you know, engaged in some capacity.
Well, the fact that you could be from here and have gone on yourself to succeed, it's a good case in point for these kids to see a successful person they can emulate.
Yeah. I 100% agree with you, Mr. Benitez. I didn't see a lot of professors that looked like me when I went to Carnegie Mellon. Actually, I tell people I didn't come across an African-American professor at Carnegie Mellon or UC Berkeley in science, technology, engineering, or math. And so that really pushed me to think critically about how I could represent people like myself.
On the other hand, a naysayer might say, well, what's so special about these particular fields? If a kid grows up and works in entertainment or social media or any number of high-paying fields, who cares what their degree is in necessarily?
Yeah, and I, to some extent, agree. Everyone is not going to pick a STEM or STEAM major, but understanding or just having some exposure to what is possible is one of the things that I try to embark upon.
So what is your view overall of the kids you dealt with? And I guess they're a pretty good cross-section of the Hammond area.
Yeah, I'm excited. I'm excited for the future. They have a very short attention span. But other than that, they've been wonderful to work with, keeping me on my toes, always, making suggestions for improvement. And I'm quite hopeful for the future.
So with all the negatives we hear about the coming generation, which, by the way, just about all the time in history that's been said, you're optimistic.
Yeah, I'm optimistic. I think we need to continue investing, into their future, but there's a lot to be hopeful for.
Well, I subscribe to the view that whatever a kid's interested in, we should have a way for them to do what they like and to go further, to be able to, if they're into music, let's get them into a music curriculum. That's hard to do, but the school system's trying to do that, trying to get every child who graduates high school to be ready for the job market if they so choose.
No, that's a really good point, and really why I thought critically about including gaming. So I had a PlayStation 5 at home just collecting dust, but I know, different generations have an affinity for gaming. And so I was thought really critical about how to implement that in the curriculum. And so we had that exposure daily.
How many children were you able to get through the program, and what ages were they?
So we had 20 participants total, ranging from 7 years old to 14. And so, we had 6 weeks, and some students participated for 6 weeks, and some students participated for 2. So it was a great, great mix of students and participation.
What will you do next?
That's a great question. I'm still figuring that out. Definitely will be back here next year, talking to the Heritage Center about some activities before then. Maybe doing something for winter break and something in between those times as well.
What else do you want to share with us?
I want to just thank Southeastern for their partnership, specifically Dr. Wendy Canero. She made a lot of what we had today possible. And also want to thank the parents and the community for continuing to support TAM.
Hi, I'm Trent Anthony with Monument Real Estate. After working several years in the real estate industry, I decided to serve the wonderful people of Southeast Louisiana by opening a locally owned company where each client is treated with a tremendous amount of respect and importance. Serving the North Shore, Baton Rouge, and New Orleans regions, Monument has the ability to broker all types of real estate transactions. Your real estate needs are very important to us, so let me or one of our team members help you make your mark with Monument Real Estate.